Good morning. What a pleasure to have you with us for what I know you're going to enjoy. Karl Koerner is one of my very best consultants in the world. I used to have most of the oral surgery courses given by oral surgeons. And what did they say 9/10 of the time? Well, don't do that, you'll get in trouble. Refer that, refer. And I got very sick and tired of that. Karl and I have been friends and associates for many, many years. And as I finally decided that with oral surgery, let's do someone who is actually doing it on a day-to-day basis on the kinds of things you see every day. I decided that about ortho. We have an ortho course coming up by a general dentist fairly soon. And you'll have the same orientation by a person by the name of Dave Wright, an unbelievable guy. This program is 3 hours, and we found that Saturday is our best day because many of you have gone back to practice and you're now working on Friday, which you never did before. I'm going to share screens with you and give you a little information about what we think we're doing. Let's do that right now. Here we go. And if you observe that slide, you will see that we have a couple of others with Karl today. We have Ward Krieger and we have Rudy Tillman. And you're looking at them if you have your screen opened up to see the people who are panelists. And they're going to be interjecting questions during this time as they see questions that come in their mind. Now, Rudy's been around a few years longer than Ward, and I'm sure you'll have different kind of questions. In fact, we were talking just before this, and Rudy was highly influenced by Karl, as I have been. I and the team, unbelievable team that works with me, will provide only the finest people we can find. Karl is one of those. He's right on the top. There's nobody I would go to faster than I would go to Karl when I have a problem. Karl, tell him what you want to tell him.
You know, I'm so glad to be here. It's an honor to be here. You know, we're good friends. We go back a long way. But, you know, you've given the opportunity here to cover surgery from the ground up, which is what we do. We talk about simple things, but those add up, you know, to become more proficient over time.
They sure do.
Unfortunately, in school, people aren't getting what they actually need.
Oh, crazy.
You can graduate watching an extraction, you know, or maybe doing one simple. But yet your patients want you to do stuff, you know, when you get in practice. They're disappointed. You disappoint them when you're not able to take a tooth out. And if there's a problem, then you should be able to handle that problem. You know, yes, we still refer some things. We have to do that and always will. But you should be able to be doing at least 90% of the surgery that's in your office.
Karl, I consider all of dentistry, especially, and all these specialties, 12 of them now that we have in dentistry, I consider subspecialties. So when someone claims to be a specialist, I think, in what? One little nitpicking thing, we need to know something about all of dentistry, and you certainly don't get that in school. There are well over 100 procedures in dentistry. And what do you get in school? Maybe 10, and not even depth in that. So Karl's going to give you the scoop, I can tell you that.
You know, we've got a lot to cover today, and we're ready to go. So whenever you want us to, we can get started. And
let's do it. Okay. Share your screen and let's get going.
Okay, so let me see. Well, we're gonna look up here first.
Oh, okay.
So Belinda, if you'd come up here, let's just talk about some things so we don't have to go back and forth. We'll get this over with and then move on to the images that I have. You know, when I say start at the beginning, we're talking about instruments. And, you know, some people say, well, this works best for me and this is my favorite. All of that is fine and good. But when it comes right down to it, what do oral surgeons learn with? What do residents in GPRs and AEGDs learn with? They provide instruments that are the basis of doing good work. Now, over and above that, if you want to get something special that really is your you know, go to, that's fine. But we need to start with the basics. And a lot of general dentists forget what they had in school. Because that's one thing the schools, I think, did well, is they had a basic set of instruments that was pretty awesome. So as we start here, let's start with the one I'm holding. There's actually, I'm going to put them together because there's two different ones. Just a good periosteal elevator. Now, you can use something else like a Woodson if you want, but these are what are usually in the programs, and it's a Molt No. 9 periosteal elevator. And if you look at it, it has one end that's smaller and extremely pointed. If it isn't pointed and sharp, and if the edges aren't sharp either, then you're going to have a hard time doing flaps. A lot of general dentists come up to me and say, I can place implants, but I can't do flaps. Really? So that's how you do it. Well, you take this instrument with a sharp tip and sharp edges, you push that tip under the edge of, into the sulcus perhaps, under the papilla, put it on bone, and then it's called push and twist, push and twist, push and twist until you lift up a couple millimeters. And after you do that, whoa, it's just slipping around to the other end. And then again, you have sharpness. I saw one that was sold at a meeting, and this edge was 1 millimeter thick. Can you imagine doing? I mean, so you can't go by some of these companies because they aren't in tune. So, and then we have two here. We have a black one and a stainless one. And of course, we all know what that means. We know that the black one is coated with a titanium alloy, which makes it not dull, you know, very fast at all. I mean, it lasts for maybe instead of having to sharpen this one after 6 months or 3 months, this one could go a lot longer than that. We have retractors, and it doesn't matter which one. There's not right and wrong here. There's just personal preference. So in oral surgery, there's absolutes, right? There's like, and we've got our mentors with us, Ward and Rudy, and feel free to say something if you want, and I will ask you things as we go along. I really appreciate you being here. You've helped me in many courses over the years, and you may not use, you know, the one I use, but it doesn't matter. So you have, for a little larger flap that is too big for the wide end of a periosteal elevator, you have this wide end of the Selden, and you have this end of the Minnesota. They are both good. Personally, my preference is the Selden, but I at the dental school, you know, they don't even have that on the tray. You have to ask for it. So this is the one, and a lot of oral surgeons are taught with that. So they're taught with both. So both are acceptable. And then as we go along, we've got a needle holder. You'd be amazed, Rudy and Ward. What do you think? You'd be amazed at how many dentists might slip to the dark side and use a curved hemostat to place sutures. Can you imagine anyone really doing that? I can't. What program in the US would they teach that? I don't think there's one. Now, if your needle holder falls on the floor and you don't have anything, well, yeah, let's use a hemostat. But hemostats are for other things. They're like a post or for a root tip down in the bottom of a socket. You know, we could probably name 10 different things they're good for, and they should be on your tray, but they're not the one for suture placement. We've got scissors, and some general dentists will look at these instruments right here and say, really? They're so big, they're so long. How can we do that? Give me that little one that's 3 inches, you know? But if you're doing like a second molar or a third molar and you need to go see past your knuckles to do a suture back there, I mean, you need something a little bit longer. Yes, maybe you could get by with some dinky little thing in the front of the mouth. But, you know, when it comes to doing actual surgery, then you need something that's multi-purpose. If we're going to remove two teeth together and end up with the interseptal bone sticking up to cause acute pain for the next week because of that interseptal bone that was up, because the papillae, you see, drop down in the sockets And then you've got this interceptal bone that's exposed bone. It's like a dry socket for the next week. So we need these two, and I keep them together usually. It's the rongeur and the bone file. I really